Hi, I'm Sheldon Harnick, musician, lyricist, composer, and I've just finished speaking to Barry Z, and I had such fun answering his questions. He asks wonderful questions. I had such fun speaking. I hope that you have fun listening and enjoy this as much as I have.
To start off,
yes.
Happy holidays and thanks for coming by.
Thank you.
Did you hear that? Happy holidays and thanks for coming by, guys and ladies. Welcome to Midnight Classic Cinema at the Cinema Village.
Yes.
And I'm your host, Barry Z, from the world famous The Barry Z Show. I hope you all watch it. Thank you. And tonight, my special guest, my special guest of all time, is Carol Ann from Mommy Dearest, the classic movie that we're going to screen for you today. Wow, you really Carol Ann, aren't you?
Or as you say, Carol Ann!
You mean, Carol Ann!
Right.
Is that good?
That's better.
And you're from that great classic movie, Mommy Dearest.
Mommy Dearest.
Which is what we're going to screen tonight. Yeah. And your real name is Ritanya Alda.
Yes.
Any relation to Alan Alda?
No, I'm not related to Alan, but I know Alan, and he's a lovely, lovely man. He came to see me in a show I did a couple of years ago.
What show?
Called Murder at Howard Johnson's. Yeah, thank you. Laughing, it was a comedy. It is a comedy. So he was very supportive and wonderful. And,
oh, nice. Was it here in New York?
Yeah, it was at the Theater Row on Theater Row.
Now, you live in New York, don't you?
I am a New Yorker.
How did you end up in this film?
Frankie Blonds was the producer of this film, and he was the president of Sigma 3, which was a small distribution company and that did the early Brian De Palma films that I starred in with Bobby De Niro called Greetings and Hi Mom.
Greetings you were in and Hi Mom?
Yes, yes.
Wow, did anyone ever see those movies?
Classic cult movies.
And Frank distributed them, and then I did The Fury with Brian that Frank produced, and so Frank Blonds recommended Frank Perry.
Wow.
That's how it came to be.
That's how it came about, huh? Yeah. Now, you also wrote a book, right, called The Carol Ann Diaries?
No, it's The Mommy Dearest Diary, Carol Ann Tells All.
The Carol Ann
But it's the Mommy
Diary.
Dearest, the
really?
Mommy Dearest Diary.
Okay, so it's not a Carol Ann Diary, it's a Mommy Dearest Diary.
Yes, because it's a whole bunch of cast of characters, not just Carol Ann, but it's everybody that worked on the movie, essentially, because
wow.
It becomes a family, and then you get to know the makeup person, you get to know the hair person, you get to know the cinematographer, you get to know other people that have a lot to say about
Dearest Diary is for sale right here in the lobby tonight.
Yes.
Tell me about the book. What is it about? About the movie.
The book is a three-parter. The first part introduces me, who was I before I was Carol Ann, and it's a little bit of a biography about my life, how I came to America, how I
from
wanted,
where
from Latvia, from Riga.
Really, you sound like you're from Brooklyn.
Thank you. Last Exit to Brooklyn, where I played our Brooklyn mom. It was fun.
Wow.
And so I came, and how I wound up in New York studying acting, and how I got into the business, and sort of my life in the 70s in the film industry in New York, where all these wonderful directors that I worked with. And then that's the first part. So the second part is the actual diary, which I actually kept. I kept a day-to-day journal of the 4 months I was on this film. I kept the journal because at the time my personal life was chaotic because my husband was having drug issues. And
is he still alive?
No, he got killed crossing the street in New York in 2006.
Well, I'm sorry.
So,
is he a famous actor?
Yes, his name is Richard Bright, and he was a wonderful actor. Oh. He did all the three Godfathers and many, many more movies. He played Al Neri in The Godfather.
You were in The Godfather, too, weren't you?
I was not. I was
you were
Richard
not.
Was. I would love to have been in The Godfather, but I wasn't.
So you were in The Godmother, then?
The God Sister. So I kept, because it was so difficult in my personal life, and it was so difficult on set with Faye, that the only way I could deal with it was to journal. And I've never journaled before, and I never journaled after. So I journaled the day-to-day, and it kind of made me more peaceful. I kind of put things in perspective as I journaled. So then I put the diary away. I never intended to publish it. I never thought, I mean, who knew that this movie would become the cult classic movie of our time?
Of all time.
Of all time. So then when I realized that there was a demand for, people wanted to know what happened, because Faye Dunaway doesn't talk about it. And
I asked a question once. I interviewed her at the premiere of a play off Broadway, and I said to her, Faye, you must have some favorite lines from this classic movie that you were in called Mommy Dearest. She goes, just like this, she goes, I don't have any.
Yes.
And that was it. That was the end of that interview.
Yeah, it's true. She refused to talk about it.
Why?
But, I don't know. She's right now. She called me a few months ago. She's writing her book on Mommy Dearest because she found out I was writing mine. And she wanted me to help her. She wanted me to fly out and help her write her book with her ghostwriter for no money, of course. And
hello, Faye.
And
knock.
So I said, well, why don't you just buy my book and you'll get a outline of what happened? Because honestly, if I hadn't journaled it, I wouldn't remember the details that I put into this book. So let's see what she uses.
Unbelievable.
I don't know.
And she didn't want to pay you anything to be a contributor.
Nothing.
Now, you...
And I would get a little note...
I hope you didn't do it.
I would get a little note somewhere...
She didn't
in the
do it,
footline.
No.
No, I didn't do it. And she's on her, I think, fifth or sixth ghostwriter now, so...
Oh, my God. What happened?
I have no idea.
They all disappeared.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Hi, it's Barry Z from The Barry Z Show, talking to the stars of The Engagement. Right, how do you spell engagement, David?
Engagement, with a capital G and a big old Y.
Why?
How big is the Y?
I have no answer to that.
Okay.
The Y is... What
did you say?
Just big enough.
Okay.
Huh? Why for yes?
Why for no? No. Well.
Why not?
Why not?
Exactly. Yes.
Yes. It's a big Y for yes, because everybody loves this show. Right?
I hope so.
And I'm going to say this. Why not have this on Broadway where it belongs, and I'm going to bring it there?
Oh, excellent. Let's do that.
Your program just fell over. I mean your memorial.
In memorial.
Yeah. So it's called The Engagement, right?
That's right. The Engagement.
Why is it called The Engagement?
Well, because, you know, it's about the central. It's a love story. It's really just a two-person love story with lots of fun stuff and numbers around it. And so, you know.
How many numbers?
Right now there's 17.
I thought you were going to say 69 for a minute.
Oh, that would be, yeah.
That's funny. Yeah. Too many.
That's the rehearsal process.
What'd you say?
Yes. That's the rehearsal process mostly. Yeah.
So this show is presented by the Gilbert and Sullivan Players, right?
No. Although it did have four members of the New York Gilbert and Sullivan Players in it. Five if you count Mark.
Oh, yeah.
As the music director.
So tell us, who is part of the Gilbert and Sullivan Players?
Me, Chris Ian. And then Seth, who played my paramour in the show, and Jason Whitfield. Yes.
Your paramour.
Yes.
Define paramour.
My lover.
Your lover.
My fiance, my husband, ultimately in the show.
Is this your real husband?
I don't want to give away the end, but but it is called The Engagement.
Wait a minute. What about the end?
Well, I said he's my husband at the end.
You get your husband in the end.
I do.
I see.
I do.
Spoiler alert.
You saw the show, right?
Yes, I've seen the show more than once.
That's right.
I heard that somebody gets it in the end here.
Somebody gets it in the end. That is correct.
Almost everyone in the cast.
What'd you say?
Almost everyone in the cast, actually.
You didn't heard?
You just breathe deeply.
What do you want to say?
Is this public television?
I'm not what you call a romantic. My feelings stay close to the vest. My family's pride was to hold it inside. But we're loyal when put to the test. But a person still longs for another, a mate to your soul and your heart. And so, my best sense is, my story commences the same as most love stories start. Just another night at the gay bar where I'm looking at the men. Who is who? Did he look at me or look at you? Can I really know? It's a complicated flirting situation. If I think a guy is hot, I can tell him. Well, not tell him. I mean, in this bar scene, nothing more than eyes. A couple tries, then he'll realize that I'm giving him an open invitation. But that doesn't mean he likes your glance. It's an interesting game of chance. If he doesn't give a stare, better drop it then and there and pretend that you are headed for the dance floor.
Well, it's just another night at the Eagle, and I'm looking for a fling, only sex.
Just a one-night thing everyone expects.
Then you go your way, and I don't intend to ever learn your last name.
If you're squeezing past the bar when you touch me, I'll assume it's what you want.
Moving toward the stair,
playing nonchalant,
acting unaware.
Then you give a wink.
It's a second-story predatory fast game.
But I really kind of like his smile.
I like his masculine but careless style.
We can maybe start to talk, but I think he's gonna box, so let's make out in the corner for a while.
Well, it's just another night at the gay bar where it's all about the butt, all about the heat.
Everyone's a slut
or a piece of meat.
That's the way it is. We don't like it, but we love it just the same.
Singing show tunes at the piano bar makes me feel like I'm a superstar. But in dim lit rooms, it's so intense. I'm a wallflower with no confidence. Why would you ever think that I had a terrifying shyness when any guy pushes up and puts his hand upon my thigh? Still, if I don't run, I'll meet someone.
Well, it's just another night at the gay bar where I'm looking for a fling. Who is that? Just one I think everyone expects. Then I go your way, and then don't say that I'm just your last stop. If you're a star, I can tell him. Well, let's tell him that you want me. As far as they're saying, I'm not in the car. Where they are the least, but a second-story predatory fast. But now the question is a yes or no.
I can't.
Do you want to stay or do you want to go?
Because I really want to
come into the car or just do it in the bar. It's the Eagles that we're leaving. Doesn't matter, 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 matter. Just another night at the gay bar. Getting lucky or not. Feeling kind of down, meeting Mr. Wrong, boyfriend's out of town. What you gonna do? This is scintillating, fascinating, sexually validating, agitating, aggravating, character assassinating. Man,
we are very
glad we love it just the same. What a crazy, captivating game.
The engagement is it's a love story. I call it the love and all that entails story.
Not love and all that jazz?
Not all that jazz, no. There's no jazz in this show. It's all real music theater.
What'd you say?
A little.
More like jazz hands, per se, than jazz anything.
Jazz light. Yes. Jazz light, a little bit.
Where's Bebe Neuwirth?
Well, she's back on Broadway, I guess. She was certainly in the Tonys.
Okay.
Killed it.
But
killed
she's
it.
Not in the engagement.
She is not in the engagement. Only one woman in the engagement. Her name is Colleen Harris.
And she's fabulous.
She is fabulous. She does it.
Is she a real woman?
She is as woman as you get.
She's a cis female.
Yes.
Cis female. Cis female.
What does that mean?
It means she was born with female parts.
Oh, I see.
Yes.
Okay. It's a very strange term, but it's what it means, yes.
But you spell it E-N-G-A-Y-M-E-N-T, right?
That's right. Engagement.
Why is it spelled that way?
Just because it's a love story that happens to be two guys. It's a love story that's two men, but it's...
Which is what gay means, really.
Is that what it means?
A little bit. I think so.
Now, is this in honor...
We don't want to make you uncomfortable.
Is this in honor... What? Is this a gay show?
This is a gay show? I thought this was Hamilton.
No. Oh, yeah.
It's a love story.
It's a human show.
It is. It's a human story.
Well, I heard there was an engagement in Hamilton, too, on stage.
I have not seen Hamilton.
Haven't you seen it? No.
No.
We can't afford Hamilton.
You can't afford $5,000 a ticket. Huh?
Mm-hmm. There was a rap in the show, but we cut it out. So, I mean.
Gotcha.
There's almost a rap.
A gay rap.
I wish I could see. What is it? I wish I could trust there is something in me he would see that would be. So, yeah, I feel a little Hamilton at that moment.
I thought your beatboxing was
so amazing. There is what? A beatbox in this or a gay rap in this?
I haven't seen any boxes beaten in the show.
No boxes allowed.
No, except Colleen. But
not even big boxes.
Okay, this is what happens when the girl is not at the table.
To defend herself. She's not here to defend herself. That's not fair.
Who was the girl we're talking about? There were a lot of girls in this show.
No, the one, yes.
I'm a lady.
Three times a lady, no?
Yes, exactly.
I am not a lady. I am so not a lady. I mean,
Wait a minute.
Definitely not. And I'm in another show where I prove that I'm not a lady. So yeah.
Didn't you wax your chest?
No. I just trim the hedges is what I do. You never want to trim the head, but you can trim the hedges pretty much.
I see.
Just so it's not like growing like the Amazon. In this way, it's like neat and kept together. It's like tidying your room up, you know, but with chest hair.
Are you the hedges in Benson and Hedges?
The hedges in Benson and Hedges? No.
No,
huh? Definitely not. Wow. No.
Do you have to shave?
It's a duo, but I mean not Benson and
Hedges. Do you have to shave your arms?
If I tried, I would have no free time if I even attempted to shave my arms.
What causes this? Is this a malfunction?
Self-loathing, mostly. Yeah, that's what contributes to it a lot.
We're opposite, actually. So.
I see.
Yes.
I want to have this when I grow up.
You want to have this? You can have it. I mean, I'll shave it off for you, make a wig, and you'll look like Joyce DeWitt a little bit. But, I mean, it'll work.
Joyce DeWitt, I don't like that woman.
You don't like Joyce DeWitt?
No.
Oh, neither did Suzanne Somers. So
she's a half-wit.
Yeah? Is she?
Yeah. I want to be John Ritter when I grow up.
Don't we all?
Yeah, exactly.
I interviewed him once.
Now, but I mean, that's like in
fabulous
a,
actor.
He was a fabulous actor, yes. And so
Three's a crowd, you know.
Not always.
Oh, Three's Company, right. Yeah, all right, so tell me what the show is about.
The show? Did we talk about
what
this
show?
Already?
What show
Which one was it?
No, this we never told the audience what the show's about.
This show, The Engagement, is just a love story. It's a love and all that entails story. It is a story of how two single people meet in New York City in a bar.
Mm-hmm. What bar?
I like to name this, it's a little piano bar named...
What?
Yes!
Rusty Anchor.
I said the Rusty Anchor. I'm a big Golden Girls fan, so.
Wow.
I like to name it Antoinette's Angst.
Oh. I see.
Yeah.
Or it could be called Mildred's Panic.
No.
Mildred Pierce?
No, just Mildred's Panic.
I see.
It could be called the Eagle,
well,
right?
We referenced the Eagle at one, in one of the songs as well. Yeah,
we
so we kind of.
Meet in the piano bar.
Which yeah. The Eagle. Yeah, you can't.
We should call it Roots Tavern.
Wait a minute. They don't have a piano at the Eagle.
No, I think the sling gets in the way. So, I mean, it just takes up too much room.
Obviously, the only time they use the piano is to tie someone to it, maybe.
That's probably true.
Anyway.
I think we just found our Saturday night plans, actually.
I will tell you the truth, though. Actually, Carlos and I did meet in the Eagle.
Oh.
So this is a love story between you and your boyfriend, Carlos.
My now husband, yes.
Okay.
Yeah, but it's inspired by. It's not certainly not a true story in any case, but
it was embellished.
It's inspired by our story and things we've been through and done and our experiences. Yeah.
Wow. So you go back how long with Carlos?
Since 2004.
Wow.
So it's been 12 years.
12 years. And where did you meet?
We met at the Eagle.
Wow. You see.
Yeah. In the show, I put it in the piano bar just because it allowed for more numbers.
Yeah.
But.
Oh, I knew you.
So that's why we referenced the eagle, but we didn't actually do it in
it. How many numbers are in this? 69?
Six.
Well, six and nine.
There's 17 numbers in this.
Wow.
Right. We only 69 in the first number.
That's right.
That's right. That's true, as a matter of fact.
Driving. We're very method here in the cast of the engagement.
This is one of the best shows I've ever seen in my life.
I don't believe you, but I thank you for saying it.
This is my second time coming.
It is your second time. You did. Yeah. I've made you come twice.
Yeah, I came more than once.
It's my job.
When you have a long enough break in between, it's easy to do that. So,
that's,
I mean...
So you're not the Gilbert and Sullivan Players, or are you?
No, we just happen to have four members of the New York Gilbert and Sullivan Players in the cast, plus Mark, our music director, is also works with the New York Gilbert and Sullivan Players. So it is a kind of an intimate family company that we've got put together here. And then there's Chris, who literally stepped in and did the show today for the first time, because the person playing the part is off doing Wizard of Oz. We call it the tiny track. And but
he's the fairy godmother in the Wizard of Oz.
I don't think that's what he's playing. I think he's
one of the Munchkins, so the substitution was actually quite fitting.
I believe he's the coroner in Wizard of Oz right now. out at St. Louis Muni, go see it. So
Chris, how long is this show in the making?
Since not this past January, but the January before. So a year.
Celebrating how many years with Carlos?
14 years together, 3 years married.
And you met him at the Eagle.
And we met at the Eagle.
And you wrote the show.
We made it last.
Wow.
And they actually had a beautiful wedding. I was there. Aww. I sang for it.
Were you the flower girl?
No, I was the ring bearer.
There we go.
You wish you were the ring bearer.
Who was the flower girl?
We didn't have a flower girl. We had a ring bearer.
Would have been your flower girl. Look, I have flowers right here.
I'm sure I sent you an invitation. I don't know what happened.
Got lost in the mail, right?
Lost in the internet.
No, lost in the mail. M-A-L-E.
I lost. Yes.
Yes, that is what it is.
It does. Yeah, it's such a fantastic show, and I mean, I'd actually seen it before because I work here at the Metropolitan Room, and
how you got involved in the show?
Well, how I got involved with the show is actually I work with Seth in another show called Naked Boys Singing off Broadway, and when they found out they were going to be losing Elliot, they hit me up and said, "Hey, can you come in and learn this stuff on the fly and do the job?" And I was like, "Yeah," I'm like, "I'd love to. I love the show." And when I saw Elliot do it, I was like, "Oh, that would be the part I'd want to do." So when Seth in the dressing room at Naked Boys, which there's not a lot of dressing going on, said, "Would you be interested?" I was like, "Yes, I'd be interested."
Hi, it's Barry Z from The Barry Z Show, talking to the legend, actor, comedian, impressionist, Larry Storch, right?
How are you? Thank you for what a build-up. Thank you very much.
Everyone loves Larry Storch, especially from F Troop, right? You were Corporal Aegon, right?
I was Corporal Aegon.
Wow.
And we almost lost the Civil War, we guys did.
The end of the Civil War was near when, quite accidentally, a hero who sneezed abruptly seized retreat and reversed it to victory. His Medal of Honor pleased and thrilled his proud little family group. While pinning it on, some blood was spilled, and so it was planned he'd command F Troop, where Indian fights are colorful sights and nobody takes a lickin', where pale face and red skin both turn chicken. When drilling and fighting get them down, they know their morale can't droop. As long as they all relax in town before they resume with a bang and a boom. F Troop!
Where's your hat? I don't see you wearing it tonight.
I think it got lost somewhere.
It had an arrow through it, right?
Oh, that's right. There was an arrow.
Unbelievable.
An unfriendly arrow.
How long was F Troop on the air? Was it two seasons?
I think it was two seasons, yeah.
And one of the seasons was in color, right?
Right.
Living Color.
Right.
ABC.
Right.
Wow.
Mm-mm.
What were your fondest memories of F Troop?
Fondest memories?
Yeah.
When Forrest Tucker was alive, working with him. They were my the fondest memories of the troupe.
Amazing.
And everyone knows you from F Troop. I once said to you, what does the F stand for in F Troop?
Watch it now.
Was it Fort Apache?
All right, that we can buy that.
Amazing.
Now, I went through your biography, and I went through all the movies you've done.
And, I mean, I don't know where to start and finish in terms of movies.
You know, you've been in so many. What were your favorite movies?
I can't remember them now.
Really?
But there were some good ones, and I was lucky enough to work with some really good actors, actresses. I was very lucky, really.
Who were the actors and actresses that you loved the most to work with?
Forrest Tucker, the guy you see there.
Right.
Oh, Melody Patterson.
Oh, wow.
They were F Troop actors and actresses. They were the ones that I really, I owe a lot to.
You also work with people like Doris Day, didn't you?
Who?
Doris Day.
Oh, my word. I can't say enough nice things about Doris Day. Wow. I really, really enjoyed working with her.
Amazing.
And you were on Broadway, too.
Yes. I'm a Broadway stage actor, really.
Amazing.
That's what I like doing best of all.
Tonight you're celebrating your 93rd birthday?
92nd.
92nd. I don't want to rush you. I don't want to make you older.
92nd.
I'll be 92 in a little while, yeah.
How do you feel about that?
I feel all right as long as I can still get up in front of the camera and make the people laugh. That's everything to me.
You're still the best. What about your cartoon voiceovers that you did?
Oh, they were very, very interesting to do, you know.
Were you Tennessee Tuxedo?
I think I was. Yes, I was.
John Adams.
We were brought up together.
Amazing, amazing.
And what about your impressions that you do? Everybody from Paul Lynde to?
Remember Paul Lynde? It looks like a twister. Yeah, I love working with Paul.
Oh.
Loved him.
You're incredible. And we love you. You performed on my live variety show in the Village one time.
Really? I don't remember that.
Yeah, the Barry Z variety show. And you also performed on my TV show on CBS that I had called the Barry Z Show on chataboutit.com. And you came on and you were doing an interview with me and Betsy Palmer.
Oh, boy.
Yeah, the good old days.
Yeah, sure, they sure were.
Is there any regrets you have in terms of your career? Many roles you wanted to do that you were never asked to do?
No, there were no roles that I was happy with every role I got, really.
And you did it all, film, Broadway, everything.
That was the crowning thing for me, to be on Broadway.
Okay, well, we hope to see you soon. Can we see you somewhere on stage doing more comedy?
Well, I hope so. I don't know when it'll happen, but I look forward to it.
And, of course, we want to see you back on TV where you belong.
Whee!
Wow. Hi, it's Barry Z from The Barry Z Show, live at the Met, talking to Bob Greenberg.
Oh, I thought we were at the Metropolitan Opera.
Yeah, I thought we were.
No.
And you hosted a fantastic show because it was a tribute to my favorite actor, impressionist. What else?
Larry Storch was, well, he wasn't just an impressionist. He was a great actor, a great character man. And voiceover. Voiceover guy, yeah. We had Chumley here from Tennessee Tuxedo. It was pretty amazing, yeah.
Hi, it's Barry Z from The Barry Z Show, also known as Barry Z from Drag Talk. And that's what we're doing today, having Drag Talk with Magnus Hastings. Is that your real name?
That is my real name. It was torture as a child, but it's quite good now.
Tell me about the book you wrote.
This is my book, Why Drag, and it's 2,224 pages, 135 drag queens all across America. It's buy it and read it and look at it.
If I dress up in drag, will you put me in it?
No.
Hi, it's Barry Z from The Barry Z Show, live in industry for Drag Talk TV, talking to the author of this fantastic book, Why Drag, by Magnus Hastings.
Hi, nice to see you, Barry.
Are you high?
No, I'm not high yet. I want to be high, though. It's just started. It's early. But give me a few hours.
You want to be 100 proof?
Yeah, just about, yeah.
Well, this book is 100 proof. Tell me about it, and why is it called Why Drag?
It's called Why Drag because I had to come up with a question to fill some page space. It's serious. I was working on all these pictures, and I was looking at putting a book together. And I went, and the best template I could find when I was going to potentially self-publish was this square one. So I had space, and I went, what am I going to put in there? So I then came up with the question, why drag? And then consequently, I got a publisher and a book deal and stuff. But the question became really part of it. And it's really important to the book because you get a glimpse into every drag queen and
ever existed.
Not that ever existed, but there's a lot in there. There's like 130 queens in there. And of all,
tell me who's in here.
Oh my God. Well, there's Lady Bunny, there's Hecklina, there's Peaches Christ, there's...
RuPaul.
No, I asked RuPaul, and I sent a long email to RuPaul.
How long was the email?
it was a long-winded thing.
Over 10 inches.
Oh, yeah. See, I'm as bad as Miss Fame at answering questions like that. No, so I sent an email but I'd already got Boy George doing the foreword, and I'd already got...
He's been on my show.
George has. Oh, yeah. He's amazing. I love him. And in the end, Ru declined to do it, but was very supportive and very sweet, and came over at DragCon and said congratulations and stuff.
So should we boycott RuPaul?
No, I've got a lot of RuPaul's queens who she's brought to attention in there. But
if not boycott, then girlcott.
Girlcott him. Her, him, when he's, I don't know.
How long did it take you to make this book?
It took me...
Bring it to life.
It took me all... there's pictures from 10 years ago, but it's took me about 3 years to do it. It was all in all, I was shooting for about 3 years.
Are you on the cover?
Yeah.
That's you?
No. That's Courtney Act. Act, who is my... Oh, sorry, Barry.
Is she here tonight?
No, she was at the launch. I had another launch of the Abbey in LA, and she was at that. And she's on AIDS Life Cycle, so right now. And then she phoned me the day before.
Wow.
She phoned me the day before and went, I think I'm going to regret it. I just rode around the block for half an hour, and I'm fucking exhausted. And so we'll see if she's having a good time.
How does a macho man like you get involved in writing a book like this?
Yeah, okay. Because I'm a fucking drag queen at heart, that's why. Oh, yeah, I was a drag child.
How tall are you?
6'4".
How many inches?
24.
Wow.
you think that's bad? I was like this little kid who was a little drag queen who got shamed out of me. But this,
we're in England.
Yeah, I grew up cross-dressing, and then by the time I was hit puberty, I was kind of wasn't doing it anymore. And then when I found my way back into drag world, it was my home and where I belonged. So it's like, it's just, it's part of me. So it's not just me going, oh, drag's cool, or is something that, you know, is fashionable. It's because I am coming from inside out and I get it. And it's they're my people. That's why.
You say to me, why drag? I say, why not?
You're not allowed to say why not. That I ask all the girls, I ask the question, and they're not allowed to say why not. It's too easy.
Really?
Say something better than that. Why drag?
Because it's a beautiful thing.
Because it's fucking everything. That's why drag.
Fucking everything.
Yeah.
So how many drag queens are in the book?
About 135.
135 drag queens. Wow.
Yeah. There's a lot.
How did you choose them?
Because it was people that it was. I wanted a complete cross section of drag queens. So I've got the best for me, the best people out of Drag Race. But I knew them
all over the world.
No, there's some. No, it's more. There's some in England and some in Australia. But basically, it's America. There's so much stuff in America, and I flew all over America, finding like pageant drag and San Francisco quirky art drag, and you know, it's kind of a real. The biggest compliment I got is another big drag photographer saw it and he said, "I will never look at drag the same way again," because it's about art. It's about drag as art and about gender confusion, and it's not just about a man. It's not a man in a dress or a wig. It's completely different.
What did you learn from the drag queen after doing this photographic journal?
Never to rely on them to turn up on time, because they never will. No.
To what?
Rely on them to turn up on time, because they never do. No, I learned. It's weird.
You know what they say? Well, better late than never.
Well, sometimes. I don't know. It's hard. It's a really hard one. About
how hard?
Depends. It's. I don't know what I learned. I keep having this question come up, It's like nothing that I didn't know, but I think I learned to be a better photographer. I think that's part of it.
So you come from the photographic end of this.
Yeah. I mean, it's like I'm a photographer, but this is my subject. And where I was in LA, I moved to LA, I was doing celebrity stuff.
On the toilet.
Yeah, doing celebrity stuff on the toilet.
That's what it sounded like from down here.
Sorry, I can't. Now, how tall are you?
Oh, about 7'5".
There you go, you see.
Seven and a half.
But, well, I've lost. I've forgotten the question now.
Yeah. Well, how did you get into this?
I felt it was just. I moved. I've been doing drag stuff, and I was well known in drag world. If you
were doing drag.
No. I was photographing drag queens, and I was well known within. If like, so for instance, Madeline Hatter, who was one of the first drag queens I did in New York, who is performing tonight. She knew exactly who I was because she knows her drag. So there were lots of the queens who were really wanted to work with me, and then then word spread, and then they all wanted to be in the book and stuff. But I mean, I can't remember. Where's my drink?
You were like a magnet, and they were all attracted to you. No.
Yeah, that'll be it.
That's it. So you did drag at one time in your life?
No, I did it as a child. When I was a kid, I would put on my sister's clothes and play with dolls, and my dad kind of loved it because he wanted eccentric children. So my sister had boxing gloves and a. Can I put this down yet?
I don't know. It's up to you.
So my.
Where do you want to put it? How far down?
I can't. I'm not quick enough to respond to your one-liners. I'm no drag queen. But no. So I was.
You're the most macho man I've ever seen in my life.
That's so mean.
I said it as a compliment.
No, I didn't think Englishmen were able to be macho. What's happening?
I don't know. What happened?
No.
Let me pick that up again, okay? I'm sorry. Okay, you're the most macho man I've ever seen. No, let me try this one more time. You're the most macho drag queen I've ever seen in my life.
Well, thank you. Thank you. I try very hard, and I'm in flats.
Are you really?
Yeah. Who knew?
Shoes do you wear?
American 13.
Why is the same thing?
Yeah, exactly. So I'm black at heart.
It took you 2 years to make this book happen, or what?
It took 3 years to make this book happen. I mean, there's images that are older than that, but it took me 3 years to really shoot the bulk of it and fly around America. And also, it was incredible to fly around America, which I'd obviously never done, and discover America. And that it's like it's different countries wherever you go. It's kind of bizarre. And like, because you mean, I'm from England, where it's tiny, and if I say you fly from LA to New York, and it's like as if I fly to Africa from England, if that makes sense. Not really.
Did you ever get that drag queen who's big and famous in London?
Which one?
She had her own talk show.
Lily Savage.
Yes, Lily Savage.
No, because Paul O'Grady doesn't do drag anymore. He stopped doing drag ages ago. I think he does it occasionally for Panto, but he doesn't do drag.
We're good.
So what happened to Lily Savage?
Lily Savage is Paul O'Grady, and Paul O'Grady has a massive chat show, and is hugely successful as Paul O'Grady. So I think he. Sorry.
Are you all right?
Yeah.
Did it go down the wrong way?
He's hugely successful as Paul O'Grady, so he didn't. You know, Lily. He kind of buried Lily. I think every now and then he brings her back for. He did, I think, Snow White on the Seven Dwarfs. So I remember running into him. He'd been on stage being the Wicked Queen or something, and there were hundreds of dwarf men running around.
We also played Miss Hannigan and Annie.
Oh, he did, didn't he? Yeah, yeah. I never saw that. That would have been incredible.
Saw Annie.
No, I saw Annie, I never saw him.
Miss Hannigan.
Which I would love to have seen. He'd be amazing.
What about Barry Humphries, who plays Dame Edna?
But I met him bizarrely while I was shooting this book. I went backstage, and me and my friend Meow Meow, who's doing a big performance with him, she took me backstage, and I sat there for 20 minutes with him and her on our own in his dressing room, and I talked about my book. But he doesn't consider himself a drag queen. He's a performance. I can't remember what he is, but it's not what he considers, and it also wouldn't fit with this book at all. It's like,
why, he's too big to fit in the book.
Yeah.
What legacy did your father leave the world?
He left the legacy of being a truth teller and to speak your mind and not be afraid of it at a time when he could speak your mind and not be afraid of it. He really blended people together in the truth, which I think is kind of interesting.
He was colorblind, wasn't he? In terms of, you know, casting,
right.
In terms of acting.
He was. I mean, Pryor's Place was one of the first, Richard Pryor Show was one of the first that had like that kind of multicultural.
Was that on ABC?
It was NBC.
Wow.
You know, canceled it after 4 shows because he came out naked.
What happened? He came out naked.
Well, I think he was in a bodysuit because NBC was saying, you can't do this, do this. And I think the statement was, so I'll come out with nothing. Wow. You know, and, you know, he was always very profound as well.
What about the rumors about him, you know, and drugs?
They're true. Drugs are true, right? Yeah. He talked about it on stage. It was no secret, you know? That's what's so funny. It's like, I think he would be appalled by Facebook and Twitter because he just told it like it was. He was like, really? I don't need someone, you know? He would just be appalled by it.
They did call him or term him Shake and Bake Pryor. What was that about?
That I don't know, and I take offense to that.
I take offense to it, too.
Right? A-holes.
A-holes, right? He was a legend.
He was a legend. And I, you know, look, every, name me one celebrity that hasn't done something that's not okay in their lives. And I think when you're that way, you know, at that time in that era, it was common. Everybody did it, unfortunately.
How old was he when he passed?
He was 65.
Of what?
I know, right? A multiple sclerosis.
Oh, that's right. My God.
Yeah.
Oh, how horrible.
Yeah. And marriage, I think that killed him too.
Yeah. Which is a Jewish wife?
No, she wasn't Jewish.
See, that'll kill you.
Right? Right?
Anyway. Going on, where can we see you next?
You can see me next in Los Angeles performing at different different clubs and yeah.
You're not leaving. Why are you leaving New York?
I gotta go to Hollywood.
You're so gorgeous. Why unbeautiful?
That's my new character. I'm serious. I'm going to create a whole character. Her name is Vivian, and that's how she's going to be. Vivian. Thank you, darling. I'm so happy to be here. I love the theater. One day I'll come back to New York when I have a man in a fur coat.
You're leaving New York and unbeautifying the city because your shining star keeps this city so gorgeous.
You're so lovely. Me too.
I love you.
Thank you. I love you too.
Have you seen more movies or what?
You can, well, like I said, The Night Watchman's coming out hopefully by October. I hope by October because it's a horror film.
What about a Broadway musical?
Right?
Please.
Please. Can I play opposite Bette Midler in Hello Dolly, right?
How do you feel about a parallel to Bette Midler?
People say like you're like a young Bette, which is funny. And
people say that you're a young Bette Midler, right? Why?
Which is funny because I don't think I'm that much younger than she is. But
you're younger.
Younger.
More beautiful and more funny.
You know what? She is one of those people like when you have that star you want to meet, like the star that got you into doing what you were doing. That's her. She's that for me. Thank you. This song leads beautifully into this song, which is almost the end of the song. Because I love, and we can start. I'll just go. So I love listening to singers like Jill Scott. Love Jill Scott. Do people know who Jill Scott is? Yeah. All right. I love Erykah Badu. People know Erykah Badu. Because that's kind of like my daughter. Right, Lauryn Hill. First of all, I love the spoken word. The spoken word. I don't know that why they have to repeat things 100 times, but they do. And so this is kind of like my homage to that in terms of love. Because I think a lot of times, you know, we meet someone. And we have that thing for them, right? And I call it pheromones. They have a smell, we have a smell, and we unite together. And you know how you know it's pheromones? Because your friend says, how the heck did he get her? Right? Or he says, how the heck, right, did she get him? But there's a coming together of the minds. And recently in my life, there have been so many men that I love. Delicious, Steve. Yeah. Delicious. I just remind you, ishes. And so, I like guys that are creative, but they're always B-R-O-K-E, broke. And I like guys that are musicians, like some that play the horn, like Miles Davis. What do we mean? Who have found each other somehow, somewhere. And you know, when you look in her eyes, the first thought in your head, well, maybe it's not the first thought, but if you sang this song, it would be the first thought in your head. And it's like, my, a funny, a valentine. Sweet, calming valentine. You make me smile. So you all kind of feeling the love in the room tonight?
your daughter grows up, do you want her to be in this business?
I want her to be whatever she wants to be, but I prefer if she's a scientist. She's really smart and good at math.
Good for you.
I know, right?
And you talked about getting remarried on stage.
Yeah, one day it will happen. I don't know when, but it'll happen.
Will you marry me?
Sure. Let's do it right now.
Really, I love you so much.
Thank you.
I'm about to say I'm going to cry.
Yay.
Love you. You are the best.
Thank you.
Tell me about your outfit before.
My outfit is done by Macy's. On the rack.
The hair.
Right. The hair is myself.
And the lips.
The lips, all me. Mac, but Mac Cosmetics. Look, right? It's
and
me.
The glasses.
And the glasses are, you know, VisionWorks.
Well, we love you so much. And your band was kick-ass.
Thank you. Kicking ass.
Hi, it's Barry Z from The Barry Z Show, talking to the legend himself, Sheldon Harnick. We're in your home here, right?
We're in my home. Wow. We're in my home, and I have to tell you that somebody pointed out to me, legend also can be pronounced leg end, which means a foot. And so when people refer to me as the legend, I think, yeah, it's the foot, Sheldon Harnick.
You are the legend. Come on. I mean, you're responsible for the most important and greatest musicals of all time, aren't you?
Well, Oklahoma was a hit. That's true. But I didn't write that.
Okay. No, talk about your claims to fame.
Well, of course, the biggest claim to fame is Fiddler on the Roof, which I don't think that Jerome Robbins gets nearly enough credit for what he contributed to that show, because it would not have been the same show without Jerry.
Let's get some background information on Fiddler on the Roof. It's currently revived now on Broadway, isn't that correct?
We have a current revival that was directed beautifully by Bartlett Sher. Yeah. Although this one, this production is different from anything that's ever been done before, because Bart was worried when we asked him to be our director. He said, you know, the show is 50 years old now. And he said, what I worry about is that there may be something missing in it to connect to young people. And we thought, well, we hope that's not true, but what do we do about that? And he said, well, let me see if I can supply something. So he kept suggesting additional scenes that might bring it up to date. And if you see the current production, you'll see that it begins with the actor, Danny Burstyn, who's playing Tevye, coming on stage, reading a book, and wearing a contemporary coat. He's obviously a contemporary figure. And so he begins to read the story. He takes the coat off. He becomes Tevye. At the end of the production, he comes back again in that same coat. And he watches the exiles, the people are leaving, the Jewish community is leaving Anatevka. And it's obviously a man from the present who is looking at his own background. And a lot of people find this extremely moving. I don't feel it's particularly necessary, but that's an added to the show. I don't know whether we will use it in future productions, but I asked the cast, in fact, I said, how do your friends react to this addition to the show? And they said about half of them love it, and about half of them either are confused by it or it doesn't mean anything. So, but because there are half of them that love it, we thought, let's leave it in.
Wow. Now, I refer to you, or will refer to you throughout this whole interview, as a musical lyricist, composer, and what else?
Musician.
Musician.
Well, I started as a fiddle player. I thought that's what I was going to be. And as a matter of fact, I went to Northwestern University because the violin teacher that I wanted to study with was teaching there. His name was Robert Quick. He had been the associate concert master of the Chicago Symphony. He's a wonderful man, wonderful violinist. But one of the reasons I chose Northwestern University was not only because of Mr. Quick, but because they had a show, the annual student review called the WAMU Show. WAMU meaning the Women's Athletic Association and the Men's Union, WAMU. The first year I was there, I had one song accepted for the WAMU Show, and it was performed by Charlotte Ray.
Wow.
Charlotte, at that time, was Charlotte Lubotsky from Milwaukee. Charlotte became a dear friend. And when we were both in our junior year, I think, Charlotte had gone to New York on the Christmas vacation. And when she came back, she sought me out, and she had an LP in her hand. And she said, Sheldon, you of all people have to listen to this LP. And I said, what is it? And she said, well, I saw a show while I was in New York called Finian's Rainbow. So she loaned me her album of Finian's Rainbow, and I listened to it. And the lyrics by Yip Harburg, the lyrics just blew me away. And suddenly I thought, rather than being a violinist, this is what I want to do. I want to write theater lyrics and follow in the footsteps of Yip Harburg.
And that's how it all happened or began?
And that's why I'm in New York, yeah. And as a matter of fact, shortly after I arrived in New York, Charlotte was working at the Village Vanguard, and she called me and she said, if you want to meet Yip Harburg, she said, I have a friend who knows him, so we invited him down to see my show, and he'll be down tonight. So I went down to the Village Vanguard, and sure enough, there was Mr. Harburg, and I met him, and I talked to him, and I said, can I play my songs for you? And he said, sure. So he invited me to his apartment. I got a pianist, because I'm not a pianist, I'm a violinist. I got a pianist, I went to his apartment. We played the songs, and he gave me some wonderful advice. One of the pieces of advice he gave me was this. He said, when you write a comedy song, he said, the people who hear it, assuming that it's a funny song, the first time they hear it, they will laugh. The second time they hear it, they know the jokes. They won't laugh. What gives the song legs is its music. So you have to try and make the music to those songs as attractive as possible. And he said, what you're doing is you have an introduction and a chorus, and you're writing your introductions like recitatives. It's like dialogue, as though you're eager to get to the chorus and use the good music. He said, don't do that. Write every note as make every note as attractive as you can. And I thought that was wonderful advice. So, and then he did something, which as far as I'm, the older I get, the more I realize how generous this was, what he did. About 3 days after I had met him, I got a card from him in the mail. It was a greeting card, and the picture on the cover was a woman playing the harp with her bare feet. But the message was, dear Sheldon, things will go well for you if you keep wanging that lyre.